Assalamualaikum semua. Welcome back to Spill the Tea episode ke berapa? Cuba teka berapa dah. Korang kena komen dekat comment section kat bawah tu episode berapa. Sebab kita nak tengok korang ingat tak lagi dah episode berapa dah Spill the Tea ni ha. Dah banyak ke Spill the Tea yang korang dah tengok ni? Cuba komen kat bawah okey. Dah episode ke berapa dah Spill the Tea kali ni. So bersama saya host untuk kali ini. Nama saya Nur Afiqah binti Ahmad Kamarudin atau korang boleh panggil Fiqah, Fiqah, Afiqah pun boleh atau nama manja gitu di kalangan rakan-rakan AIMS. Diorang panggil saya Dodo. Dodo pun boleh. Okey, seperti yang korang tengok kat topik kita kat atas ni, becoming an event lecturer. So, dekat je becoming an event lecturer ni, korang mesti dah tahu dah, oh ni sharing about macam mana kita nak jadi event lecturer. Challenge dia apa, qualification dia apa and apa seronok ke jadi lecturer ni. Tapi, okay, tapi walaupun nama dia event lecturer, okay, walaupun nama dia event lecturer, kalau korang tak nak jadi event lecturer pun tak apa, nak jadi HR lecturer ke, korang nak jadi engineering lecturer ke, pun boleh dengar sebab sharing kita pada hari ni tea and coffee gitu. Tea and coffee kita pada hari ini akan membincangkan step macam mana challenge-challenge serta qualification yang korang perlu ada dalam diri seorang yang ingin menjadi seorang lecturer. Ha, macam itulah lebih kurang. Okay, tapi hari ini saya tidak keseorangan, takkanlah saya nak cakap sama seorang kat sini kan. So saya bersama dua orang panelis yang sangatlah berdedikasi dalam mengajar dan bersama anak muridnya. Kita ada dua pensyarah yang merupakan juga alumni kita. Alumni Avengers. So saya perkenalkan dulu sebelum saya jemput Miss-Miss kita masuk ke dalam ini. Okay, Miss pertama kita ada Miss Khairiyah atau lebih mesra dipanggil Miss Kai. So Miss Kai ni adalah seorang alumni Avengers juga daripada batch kedua Avengers. Lama tu eh. Batch kedua Avengers daripada My Event. My Event, kalau korang tahu My Event iaitu batch kedua. And then yang kedua, panelis kita yang kedua, kita ada yang kalau korang student UiTM Kedah, tak lain tak bukan mesti kenal punya. Kita ada Miss Diana Hassan atau lebih dikenali sebagai Miss Nana, juga merupakan perahi UiTM Merbuk. Kalau Miss Kai tadi kita ada di Taylor University, kalau Miss Nana kita ada di UiTM Merbuk. Ha, so tanpa melengahkan masa, oh, Miss Nanda juga merupakan seorang alumni ya. Merupakan seorang alumni Avengers daripada batch ketiga iaitu Surya Event. Okay, tanpa melengahkan masa, kita akan panggillah Miss-Miss kita masuk ke dalam layar skrin. Hai Miss.
Hai.
Hello, hai Miss Kai, Miss Nana.
Hello, hai Afiqah. Hai Miss Kai.
Sihat Miss? Nana, Miss Kai sihat.
Alhamdulillah.
Miss Kai, Miss Nana sihat.
Sihat. Sihat, seronok sebab dapat jumpa orang.
Okay. Seronok kan? Ha, so, nampak tak hari ni Miss Kai dengan Miss Nana segak-segak hari nak sharing kat korang macam mana nak jadi lecturer. Ha, gitu. So, sebelum saya teruskanlah dengan sharing ataupun question yang pertama, saya nak cakap kepada para penonton di YouTube tu, kalau korang ada any question, ada soal sebarang soalan, boleh dia ajukan soalan tu kat ruangan komen dekat bawah tu. Nanti kita akan baca lah, kita akan baca dan jawab sepanjang sharing session ini berlangsung. Okay?
Betul.
Okay, semua? Kalau okay, cakap okay dekat ruangan komen tu. Okay. Okay. So kita akan jump terus lah ke soalan pertama sebab kita ada banyak sangat soalan yang kita nak tanya kat Miss-Miss ni. Soalan yang pertama kita nak tanya, Miss Kai dengan Miss Nana ni memang nak jadi lecturer ke? Memang nak ada dalam line akademik ke? Atau sebelum ni nak jadi polis ke? Bomber ke? Macam mana tu? Siapa dulu?
Miss Nana dulu. Miss Kai dulu sebab Miss Kai senior saya. Tiba.
Alright.
Miss Kai dulu.
Assalamualaikum to all the students because I'm using laptop so I can see that the chat from other laptop. So, hi everyone. My name is Khairiyah Ismail. I am the event lecturer from Taylor University. And back to the question asking by Afiqah just now, if apa, I really want to be as a lecturer kan?
Yeah.
I want to say, yes, I am. Memang daripada kecil. Because by then at the time, kita tak ada, kita tak tahu term lecturer, right? Kita just tahu teacher. When our teacher ask, okay, nak jadi apa? Nak jadi apa? Cikgu. So, there's a few reasons why I want to be as a teacher or educator. First, because there's only profession that we can see. When we go to the school every day, we just jumpa cikgu. And then second, because my parents are teachers. And then the third reason, because I feel macam best jadi cikgu ni. So that's time lah masa I was kids kan. And then when it comes to reason of why I feel that macam best jadi lecturer or jadi cikgu. First, since I mentioned that my parents is a teachers, and then there's a few times that my dad bring me to his class tau. So, bawa I pergi ke kelas je, sometimes lah, just a few times. And then dia, he mentioned that, duduk diam-diam, jangan sentuh apa-apa, jangan pergi mana-mana. So, I being as the observer, okay, I saw how my dad teach because he teach kemarin hidup. You know, it's a skill. Kan? So, that's the first reason.
Patut dia kat jangan sentuh apa-apa.
Itulah, jangan sentuh apa-apa. Because kan kemarin hidup kan, dia ada wayar, wayar semua. And the second reason is, there's first sometimes that he asked me to marking tau. So you know, but then it's only multiple choice. Kan dia ada A, B, C, use OMR tick kan? So just tick, tick. So I feel like the best je. So the two reason why I always want to be a OMR educator. Yes, because Teacher's Day.
Teacher's Day. Hadiah banyak.
Yeah, so during Teacher's Day, I always be the one that excited to wait present yang students bagi to my dad lah. Because my dad start his journey as a teacher dekat sekolah menengah. Lepas tu sekolah rendah is guru besar. So we can see that the difference of type of present tau. And then when it comes to sekolah rendah, dia punya present tu comel-comel je. Kadang-kadang, you know, because I'm from Melaka, kadang-kadang belacan. Okay, there's sometimes that, you know, kita menang. So that, yeah. So
betul, student sekolah dia bagi hadiah kat cikgu, dia macam benda yang very relatable, like very everyday lah, kat sabun tiba dapat kan. Belacan
betul. Mak I pun, sebab mak I pun cikgu juga.
So mak I pun dapat cikgu hadiah.
Selalu kalau hari-hari guru, ayah kan yang paling excited ambil hadiah-hadiah.
Kan, korang yang buka hadiah kan.
Present tu.
Ya, betul-betul.
Betul. So back to your question, I really memang from the kids lagi, I memang nak jadi cikgu. Tapi masa cikgu lah, kita tak terfikir pun as a lecturer. Yes, that's actually me lah. So I don't know Miss Nana macam mana.
Kalau I pula, honestly, I tak pernah ada cita-cita nak jadi pensyarah. And let alone, bukan cikgu pun tak ada, let alone pensyarah macam tu. But those are the profession yang I memang look up to lah. Kan daripada apa nama tu zaman belajar, because kita punya childhood ni, especially I think my generation and also Miss Khairiyah punya generation lah, kita bila kita apa nama tu, when we took look back into our childhood, the thing that we remember most is our studying punya time lah kan, bukan saja kawan-kawan. Betul. But also teachers. Betul. Teachers, and then masa I belajar pun, and my diploma, my degree, my master's level, I always have this bond with my lecturers, tapi I was never inspired enough and sampai rasa macam nak jadi pensyarah lah macam tu, seronok ni tengok Miss Azura mengajar, nak jadi pensyarah jugalah, tak ada kan. So how did I became a lecturer, it was actually orang lain, macam orang luar punya rasa yakin pada kita. Dia kata macam, Nana you can teach lah, really. So saya cakap, macam mana nak cakap, aku cakap macam pondan-pondan, macam mana aku nak cakap. Dan dengan student macam, how do I teach, I don't know how to teach, you know, macam that flair of a teacher tu, I don't think I have, macam tu. And I boleh sembang, I suka sembang, I really love to, apa nama tu, talk and chat with apa students ke, kawan-kawan ke, kan, my lecturer even. I rasa sebab tu lah, macam among our batch yang menjadi pensyarah, apa nama tu, I was the kira paling cepat yang boleh buang kataan Miss ataupun Madam dekat macam tu address our previous lecturer yang sekarang dah jadi our colleague kan. Macam tu I perasan Miss Kai masih address Zura as Miss Zura kan. Sekarang ni I tak ada sebab kan. I really understand that.
Yeah, there's a few times Miss Azura kata, I don't need to call Miss lah, just call me Azura. Because she's my supervisor. Maybe for those yang, because I look at the chatting, ada yang kata, wah betul-betul lama ni. Yes, because that one back in 2008 or 2009. Lama. So tak tahulah yang adik-adik semua ni masa tu umur berapa.
Kan? Itulah betul. Yeah, so I never had the intention. Itulah kan, tak ada lagi. So masa kecil-kecil tu macam main-main lah. Macam cita-cita tu sentiasa berubah. Tapi bila kita dah set our mind to become pensyarah tu, jadi lecturer tu, and of course it's loads of fun sampai sekarang ni, Alhamdulillah.
So fun. So Miss, kalau Miss Kai, Miss Kai memang nak jadi pesara. Kalau Miss Nana dia tak, bukanlah nak jadi pensyarah pun daripada awal gitu. So korang kalau ada yang dekat chat tu macam korang macam tak tahu idea apa, mungkin pensyarah merupakan salah satu profesi yang perlu korang
consider.
Okay. Okay, soalan yang kedua saya nak tanya. Macam tertanya-tanyalah, kalau macam nak jadi lecturer ni kan, boleh tak terus masuk jadi lecturer ataupun nak kena work dulu dalam industri, macam kerja dulu kat macam mana-mana company lepas tu baru boleh masuk, ataupun boleh terus habis master or PhD terus masuk je, tak payah tak ada experience macam tu, boleh ke?
Kalau I, ini because soalan ni very like subjective lah, macam tanya cantik tak macam tu kan. So it's very in the eyes of the beholder macam tu. And then I am speaking on my experience ataupun I punya pendapat and my opinion lah. Especially bila you fikir nak jadi ataupun you bercita-cita nak jadi event lecturer ataupun feel yang kena ada hands-on punya experience, I would advise students untuk enter the industry dulu kan. Sebenarnya kalau you treat your practical training tu macam you're working seriously as a part of that organisation pun dah cukup bagus lah sebenarnya kan. Maksudnya you pergi intern, you tak rasa macam oh I ni intern je kan, I'm ready to photostat a few papers lepas tu buat kopi. No kan, you kena ada satu mindset yang you are a part of the organisation. Lepas tu daripada situ you would build rasa belongingness in the industry kan. Lepas tu you rasa nak mingle ataupun you nak stay in the industry lama enough untuk kutip experience, baru you boleh bawa pergi ke academic punya industry. Because when you dealing with learners ni, diorang nak tahu what's going on out there. So macam ni kita nak share what's going on out there kalau kita tak pernah ada, macam tu lah. Itu that's why I cakap ini adalah my personal experience. Even macam sekarang ni Afika, I dah mengajar 9 tahun dah, tapi alhamdulillah it's in different field tau. Dulu I pernah jadi event lecturer, lepas tu sekarang ni dekat Kedah ni tak ada event, so I terpaksa mengajar benda baru kan. So because I belajar benda baru, it's always relearning for me. Tapi kadang-kadang kita rindu nak macam relevan lagi ke teori kan, teori yang kita ajar ni relevan lagi ke in the industry kan. So that's my opinion lah. Okay, jangan terlalu terkejar-kejar nak masuk ke dalam academician line tu just because it's convenience. Tapi go and like isi you punya can ataupun you punya tong tu kan. So you banyak benda nak boleh share dengan your students and potential students nanti. Miss Kai, boleh you punya opinion.
For me if I want to answer your question Afika, can I share my slides? I mean for you.
Boleh.
I could prepare the slide, so I will share. It's actually my journey.
Cikgu saya kan. Okay.
And then even I ask Miss Azura, can I prepare slide ke? And then dia gelak dekat I. Right, so is it appear now? Is it appear now?
Okay, that appear.
Alright, so basically everyone again. Okay, so as you can see from the slide itself, I'm the stream coordinator as well as the event lecturer from TELUS University. And then this is my journey. So this is the one that I want to share with all the students here, or maybe because you are not my students, so maybe adik-adik lah. Okay, adik-adik. Okay, which is I start my journey in diploma in office management at UiTM Jengke. So you can see the year there, 2003 until 2006. Then after that, I further my degree in Bachelor of Event Management di UiTM Shah Alam 2006 until 2009. So basically, I was the last semester or last batch that stay in Section 2 Shah Alam, because the next semester tu semua move to Puncak Alam. So I tak ada experience pun how the Puncak Alam University looks like, something like that kan. Lepas tu when it comes to the third one, back to the question asking by Afika just now, I have industrial experience. So 2009 is a few years after that. And then move up after get experience journey, after that I work at the MSU as an event lecturer. Tapi masa ni I tak ada masa tau. So I believe that there will be one question asking by Afika after this, what is the minimum requirement to be as a lecturer kan. So I will share after this as well. Lepas tu move to 5, yes. I further my master in tourism management, majoring event management in UiTM Shah Alam, 2014-2015. Then after that, I get offered at Telus University as an event lecturer. And then at that time, I tak viva pun lagi. So Alhamdulillah, it's actually rezeki lah. And then I'm being as a, currently, I'm being at the stream coordinator, internship module leader, as well as the event lecturer. So start from 2015 until now. So basically my experience in education industry, I think dah lebih kurang dalam 10 tahun lah. Okay, since 2011. Right, so the next slide I have. Okay, I just want to share here. This is the moment when I believe that, or I feel that I want to be in event industry, because this is my final project for diploma at UiTM Jengke. And as you can see, actually I not remember the year, tapi luckily there's a banner over there in mentioned 2005.
So yeah.
2005. This is my final project dekat UiTM Jengke. You know what's actually event? This is something like family day with orang asli. And then when we said about orang asli, kita is a family day. The next day tu, kita kena tidur dekat sekolah ni. And then malam tu kita dikacau tau dengan ada kata hantu jenglot, ada kata pocong. So yes, that's actually the experience that we have. And the next day, when the event start, kita tak tahu dari mana orang asli ramai sangat datang. But then that time, kita punya makanan je seban je. Kita tak ada lah macam nasi goreng pataya ke nasi goreng, nasi ayam tak ada. Kita seban dengan air kotak je. But because of the challenges, because of the experience yang kita hadapi, yang kita daripada event ni, that's what I feel that, I love lah event. So this is actually the moment. And then this is the final year project. So those who are asking, I'm from which batch? 2008. Okay, this is my final year project. And then actually for this one, we have around 15 students. And then I think there's a few people is not here yet. And then if you can spot, ada dua apa ni? Lembaga dekat sini tengah tidur. And then this is actually Munir, Munir and Razali, because we are very tired. So this is 2008. And then I just want to share my experience. This is actually the event the event that I have organized in MSU. And then back to Telus, this is the event at Telus. Actually, it will be very easy to spot me because first, dekat Telus, I will be only the one yang wear tudung. And then the second one, I will be the shortest dengan the smallest. So you can spot from the photo actually, kan?
Kan, budak sekarang tinggi tu.
The smallest. And then you can, as you can see, this is the next photo. And then this photo, yang dengan Mak Saleh ni, they are actually our exchange students. So can you spot? Bukan dia orang besar tau, it's actually I yang kecil.
Okay. Forever.
So this is all the experience that I have. Okay, and then yes, so for all of you, I will say that enjoy your journey. And then if I would like to go back to question asking by Afika just now, I already stopped my screen, kan?
Yeah, dah.
Is it real that we need to work industry? I would say that it actually depends to the background. Because kalau events management, because we know events management, kan, if you cannot depends on the theoretical. You can have two things, which is practical skill dengan communication skill. Mana nak dapat communication dengan practical? Ada tak dalam buku? Tak ada, kan?
Okay.
So that's why we need to work first to get the practical skill, to get the communication skill. Kenapa we need this experience? Because first, it will be easier for you to communicate with the students. Second, you will use the experience that you have in the teaching itself. Because sometimes, for example, let's say Afika, because I heard that you want to be as a lecturer, kan? Okay, so let's say Afika, in the class, kan, they say this contoh Afika. You did not have experience, and then student asked you a question, Miss Afika, what we need to do if suddenly the risk occurred during our event? So kalau you did not have experience, you will refer to the book. Or the first thing, the first step, need to. The second step, third step. So that's actually the thing that you need to you inform the student. Tapi bila you have experience, you boleh relate balik, kan? You relate balik from the book and then from your experience. Kan, sebab kalau kata, because it happened before tau, it's actually not me, my friends. When she teach, okay, she refer to the book, she refer to the slides, and then the student complain. Alah, daripada buku kita boleh baca. So that's actually the young generation. I don't know the next generation lah. So students very outspoken. Dia tak suka, dia cakap. Dia suka, dia cakap.
Dia sebenarnya, dia orang, they are very challenging, kan? Ada yang different, the different between cikgu dan pensyarah ni kan, in academic yang apa nama higher learning ni, kita kita learn together rather than we teach you lah, macam tu kan. We are actually learning together. There are some things yang kita tak boleh tipu, yang kata kita pun tak tahu kan, because I've never experienced that as well. So kita learn together kan. So apa nama, yang cikgu ni dia lain, dia impart knowledge macam okay, satu-satu dia ajar, and they have to the students also have to macam keluarkan sebiji-sebiji sama macam tu juga. Tapi in higher learning punya education ni, dia different sikit, because it's we are preparing you to the industry, sending you out lepas ni kan. So that's why apa nama tu, macam Miss cakap tadi lah, it's either you work first in the industry ataupun you acquire the skills yang Miss Kai sebut tadi tu. And not necessarily by working sebenarnya, by going to courses kan, ataupun you apa nama tu, you volunteer for programs, ataupun you macam-macam lah cara sebenarnya sekarang ni nak acquire skills kan, not only by duduk jadi seorang pelajar saja macam tu.
Betul. Ya, itu saja Afika.
Betul. Betul, sebab saya
Afika
pun
macam tengah break je. Okay, lah. Macam, ni.
So, sebab saya pun as a student self, saya pun macam betul lah macam yang Miss Kai cakap tadi, student tu dia selalu macam kalau lecturer tu ada banyak experience, kita akan suka dengar macam oh macam tu, oh barulah kita macam nampak that macam bayangan tu very clear macam tu.
Yes, kita boleh, kita bagi you some imagination for you tu kan. So sebab tu lah kalau dalam kelas I pun, in fact I suka suruh student berangan. Betul. Kan macam okay, you imagine, you letak diri you sekarang ni, you adalah macam tu, because only by that you can apply what you're learning in your theory tu. So macam tu lah.
Betul.
And then actually the students,
dia macam lagi senang faham.
Love to hear our experience lah. Betul. They love to hear our experience, and sometimes we want more, miss more. So it's this way.
Cerita lah lagi macam tu kan. Macam budak-budak dengar bad time story macam tu.
Betul. Sangat betul, sebab saya pun macam tu juga. Kita tengah kadang-kadang masa, okay dulu Miss Nana tu my lecturer, my PR lecturer. So so dalam kelas kan, selalu macam bayangkan, okay dulu kan, dulu Miss Nana like very dekat apa tu, yang kebudayaan tu kan. Miss always cerita yang pasal experience dia. Always lah, so very very enjoy lah yang the story tu, and can relate dengan subject lah macam tu. Okay. Kalau macam tu, next, macam tadi yang Miss Kai cakap, saya akan tanya macam minimal ataupun qualification. Macam mana nak jadi, nak ada lecturer ni, what minimal qualification? Nak kena ada master je ke boleh masuk? Ataupun kena ada PhD baru boleh masuk?
Okay, a good question. Sebab
so, and then macam mana kita nak apply jadi lecturer tu itself?
Right, it's a good question, tapi I will share based on my experience tau. My experience 10 years before and now is completely different. Okay, like I mentioned just now my journey, I start my journey as a lecturer as apa tu dekat MSU, but that time I tak ada master. So if I refer back to my staff ID, dia just treat you as a tutor. Dia bukan lecturer, sebab dia kata if you want to change your position as a lecturer, you need to have a master. Tapi tak ada master, ambillah tutor. Tapi in terms of the job scope, sama je. You need to teach, okay, you need to do all the admin part.
Sebenarnya so grade dan gaji lah
berbeza. Sebenarnya gaji kan, okay, because it's actually the apa tu private university. Itu itu dululah, which is I just join, even masa I dapat masuk join talents pun, I tak ada master lagi, which is not graduate yet. Like I mentioned just now, I tak viva pun lagi. But talents kata, yes, we can accept your application, but you need to get a confirmation letter from the faculty mention that you are in the final semester, okay, and then you will do your viva soon. So I still remember, I go back to the faculty of hotel and tourism at UiTM. I asked Dr. Noliza, masa tu program coordinator, doctor boleh tak write official letter for me, because I apply from TELUS. So tak pernah dibuat lah. Dia kata yes, and then we recommend Khairiyah to be da-da-da-da. Then after two stages actually for the interview, okay, kita buat mock teaching. Okay, mock teaching is very important when it comes to the application as a lecturer. And then Alhamdulillah lepas tu dapatlah rezeki. Itu dulu. Tapi sekarang, like I don't know the other university, private university, macam TELUS, dia dah tak ambil, of course tak ambil bachelor dah. Master pun dah tak ambil. So the minimum requirement is actually PhD. Itu pun with a good research background. They will look at your publication. Kalau ada publication Q1, Q2, okay, scopus ke tak, dia tengok kat situ. So that's why I said that 10 years before dengan sekarang lain, because dah ramai orang pandai-pandai, you all semua pandai-pandai. So you need to compete among yourself. Ha, tu yeah, that's actually my experience lah. Miss Nana is different because she's from UiTM.
Government IPTN IPTS I dulu ingatkan apa nama tu IPTS still accepts master academic qualification lah, so apparently not, so samalah sekarang ni dengan IPTA pun. Tapi kan ada tapi dia dekat sini, maksudnya masih ada sinar lah. There are some faculties ataupun bidang macam bila macam kita dekat UiTM kan, faculty business saja dekat UiTM Merbok sini, degree programs je ada 10. Kan, so 10 apa nama tu program, maksudnya ada 10 bachelor degrees. Some bachelor degrees bila dia for pensyarah, dia orang memang nakkan candidate yang ada PhD, maksudnya memang dah ada doktor lah. So sebenarnya I, Miss Kai kan, ramai lagi lah my friends, kita orang sangat-sangat beruntung because we are the kira macam exception yang diterima. Alhamdulillah dah sah jawatan dah pun yang hanya menggunakan master's qualification kan. Lepas tu ada certain bidang because dia punya keperluan tu sangat mendesak kan, very very apa nama tu urgent, so there are some fields yang pensyarah boleh diambil ataupun boleh di hire just using their master's qualification. So you have to be macam you sebagai candidate, you yang nak jadi pensyarah ni, you kena search kan, you have to search apa nama tu different faculties, bukan setakat different faculties, different bidang lagi. Macam tu, macam kalau I nak jadi faculty business punya lah, and then faculty business ada 10 program, so which programs yang dia minta minimum qualification dia, master's. Sebab masa tu mungkin you baru ada master's, tapi kalau kita punya cadangan, I think Miss Kai would share apa nama tu a similar point of view. Sekarang ni if you really have your eye on becoming an academician, it is very advisable for you to continue sampai PhD lah, kan, get yourself a doctorate. Sebabnya memang it's macam, dia macam mana, dia macam wajib ada lah sekarang ni, because academician you have to have your philosophy punya doctorate tu. So daripada sekarang you plan ahead sampailah ke PhD, sebab sekarang you all baru bachelor degree kan. So macam tu lah.
Tapi Afika, can I add something?
Yes, okay. Yes, boleh.
So, okay. Dah lupa lah pula. lupa.
Pasal apa tu? I cakap apa tadi pasal plan journey, PhD sekarang, daripada sekarang boleh plan.
Okay. Just dah dari. So, actually kan, myself.
The trigger.
If macam let's say my students, okay, my ex-students or maybe my family members kan, dia kata, boleh tak kalau I further master? The first question is, kenapa nak further master? So kalau let's say dia kata nak further master to be as a lecturer, I will say that susah nak dapat because it's actually fresh. From diploma, habis diploma, jump to bachelor, habis bachelor, jump to master, mana experience je? Because I have experience before when I go for interview, kan, masa tu memang I just finish my bachelor. Lepas tu dia tanya, interview tanya, you tak ada experience, how can you teach our students? So dia macam menikam kalbu tau, dia punya ayat tu. So bila menikam kalbu tu, kita kata okay, if since I really want to be as a lecturer, I need to do something. Since I know that the requirement is the experience, that's why if I share my journey tadi kan, I need to join involved in the industry first, ambil sikit experience, and then I go back. And actually I went to the same institution, dah lepas lah kan, because actually just now. Okay, and then I have been interviewed by the same HR manager. Oh baguslah, you ada experience. So nampak tak? Kalau lah cakap dengan dia, you lah yang kata I tak ada experience dulu. 3 years kan?
Kan. Tu so apa begitu nampak sangat tu, terasa tu koyak.
Betul. Kan. Dia macam menikam kalbu, so macam like okay, I need to get experience. And then the first thing, the second thing, macam I cakap tadi, once I finish my bachelor, I get married. Macam okay, dah tak dia macam
bukan cinta, okay, macam cinta
jodoh, okay, dah jodoh. So I get married, okay, and then masa I get married tu I struggle very hard to get a job, okay, because you know when you married and then the rezeki back at pregnant, okay, the moment you enter the interview room dengan your apa tu baby bump tu kan, lepas tu the panel will be like, oh pregnant. So it's very cynical. So they will feel that pregnant. So if we get you to job apa to work with us, then you will go for the maternity leave. Tak apa lah. So that's reason why you really need to how to say, to plan your journey. Tapi macam mana pun semua bergantunglah pada rezeki kan. Ada rezeki insyaAllah. Ya.
Yeah. Plan tu maksudnya bukanlah okay, Afika lepas tu duduk dengan papa mama cakap okay pa, lepas habis degree ni I teruskan sama master, lepas teruskan. Bukan, bukan maksudnya, bukan maksud I macam tu. Maksud I maksudnya betul, along the way tu. Ya, yeah, sebab nampak
my,
tu kat muka kau.
Sebab tu. My mom cakap, kau habis degree, kau sambung terus ni. Kau sambung terus habis ni. Macam tu lah. Tapi macam. Ya, tu lah.
Kan lah. So, maksudnya kita, masa kita tadi, you having a plan tu maksudnya along the way, macam while you're working, while you're collecting your experience from working tu, at the back of your head tu mesti ada dah plan untuk PhD tu kan. So tengok what's wrong in the industry, apa isu yang you boleh encounter, lepas tu jadikan tu topik sebagai you punya PhD tak? Itu ajar orang kan, sendiri tak buat. Okay, so apa maksudnya, you boleh gunakan your working experience tu untuk membantu you to you juga nanti masa you nak buat PhD tu. I nasihatkan you, so I nasihatkan diri I jugalah ni. Okay, supaya I pun sama macam Miss Kai yang dah, yes, yang dah hujung-hujung journey PhD dia. Semoga dipermudahkan.
InsyaAllah.
Amin. Itu tadi, kan tadi Miss Kai dengan Miss Nana share qualification kan. Dia macam kalau step nak masuk pula tadi tu, ada macam step nak minta. Macam minta daripada admit universiti tu terus ke? Ataupun macam ada orang recommend, kena recommend ke macam mana?
Maybe I can share lah sebab I private university kan.
PTS kan? Ha.
So macam private university, like mentioned just now before I went to, I join MSU, banyak application I send. Kata je kat mana college yang I dengar, the events I try, I submit. When I said I submit, meaning that I manually submit. It's either I send an email to them ataupun I bagi macam macam apa kata, we put extra effort, we go to the college, nah, this is hard copy. So that's actually what I'm done. And then when I join MSU, it same goes, which is I submit my application. Dia masa tu tak open pun, any vacancy. And then masa I join Taylor's University, it's actually one of my friend who work at Taylor's University asked me. So masa tu I in semester, last semester in my master, and then she asked me, Kai, you nak join tak Taylor's because there's a vacancy. And then luckily lah, it's actually luckily they didn't do the advertising about that position. So I was like, okay lah, I try my best. Okay, sebab because that time I was thinking that lepas master nak buat apa? Sebab tak dapat kerja kan? So I try to submit manually, like I mentioned just now, hard copy. I just went to Taylor's University, submit. Alhamdulillah, ada rezeki lepas tu. Because if for example, you will submit to like for example JobScript, they memang open for vacancy, then will be quite difficult. Because why? You need to compete with other applicant kan?
Kalau dalam industri apa tu? IPTA pula, kalau misalnya kan IPTA macam mana dia nak masuk?
Okay, so I akan cerita dua jalan. Okay, dua jalan eh. Satu daripada I punya pengalaman sendiri. Okay, so I was recruited by UiTM using this scheme yang dipanggil Tenaga Pengajar Muda. Okay, TPM kita panggil dia. Bukan Timbalan Perdana Menteri. I wish. Okay, so Tenaga Pengajar Muda. So TPM ni adalah satu scholarship yang dikeluarkan oleh UiTM and actually ada pelbagai universiti IPTA yang keluarkan scholarship yang sama. Mungkin nama dia berbeza, tapi bila you ambil ataupun bila you mohon untuk tenaga pengajar punya IPTA punya scholarship ni, you akan apa nama tu, dibiaya untuk menyambung you punya study, untuk continue your study in master's level ataupun PhD level. And then after that you will get apa nama tu, akan diserap masuk di universiti tu untuk menjadi pencerah lah. Dan biasanya you are going to be bonded with the university. So macam I dulu, I punya scholarship tu tahun 2010 ke 2011. I tak ingat, tapi I masuk, I join UiTM 2012 lah. Kan, master's was only 1.5 year je, pendek je masa dia tu kan. So scholarship tu kita dapat and then kita sambung belajar masters dibiaya oleh UiTM. So tapi tak boleh bekerja masa tu. So bila kita dapat scholarship tu, kita dah tak boleh bekerja lah. Dah kena berhenti kerja kan. Lepas tu kita sambung belajar, habiskan belajar and then after that kita terus masuk mengajar and bonded with UiTM selama 7 tahun. And then bukanlah habis 7 tahun tu dia akan okay bye bye thank you, tak ada. Maksudnya teruskan sambung lah. Maksudnya within that, yeah, within that 7 years tu, you cannot leave the organisation. Kalau you leave, yeah, there's an an amount for you to pay lah. Okay. Satu lagi untuk yang direct punya. Okay, so ini adalah untuk pensyarah-pensyarah yang bukan daripada skim tenaga pengajar muda ni. Once you have acquired your minimum qualification for that position tu, kebanyakannya sekarang ni memang DM52 lah, iaitu pensyarah yang ada qualification PhD, maksudnya kena dah ada doktor, kan? There will be iklan, advertisement everywhere. And sekarang ni kita tidak hire through JPA dah. Kita hire direct to the university. Macam UITM, you follow lah all the social media, Facebook ke kan. And bila I kata Facebook ni, setiap campus dia ada different Facebook tau. And macam UITM pun sebenarnya kita, UITM Kedah baru je keluarkan satu iklan looking for lecturers untuk especially English, APB lah, Academy Pengajian Bahasa. Lepas tu Faculty of Business pun kita ada cari juga, tapi lebih kepada major in finance, Islamic banking dan sebagainya macam tu. So maksudnya direct recruitment from university, from different campuses pun memang dah ada dah sekarang ni, walaupun untuk IPTA. So ada dua jalan lah. Satu, you keep a lookout for scholarship tu, TPM tu, because TPM tu dia lebih convincing ataupun lebih menjamin lah, kan, lebih menjamin, because memang tahu-tahu dah lepas kita habis belajar confirm saya akan jadi pensyarah UITM. So it was like a very secure punya tu lah, kan.
Secure
so,
job, kan?
Yeah, that was one of the reason kenapa I ambil juga ataupun I agree juga jadi pensyarah dululah in 2011. Lepas tu kita dah kerja lah industri, kan, so macam happy lah, seronok, huha-huha sana sini hari, kan. Tapi lepas tu bila kita dapat offer TPM tu, kita rasa macam I'm happy with the salary, I'm happy with the work, I'm happy, kan. Cuma mungkin tak ada life sikit lah, tapi as long as you treating your job to as your life, adalah life, kan. So adakan I nak tak jadi pensyarah, kan. Layak ke macam rasa macam boleh ke ngajar anak apa macam nak ngajar ni, kan, ilmu ni something yang very like sacred macam tu, kan. So macam risau juga. So I talk to my Miss Zura, I cakap dengan PM Haslina, those are all my lecturers jugalah dulu, kan, kawan-kawan yang kenal, family members. Lepas tu baru kita buat decision lah. So dua cara tadi, TPM and also direct. Maksudnya you have to acquire your minimum academic qualification juga dulu. Okay, macam saya cakap tadi, kalau boleh sekarang ni just aim for PhD, because that's the requirement. Kita nak kata minimum tak juga, because dalam academic tu memang dah, itu dah maximum dah. Kan, I rasa Natasha ada soalan.
Ada soalan. Ada soalan kat situ, dia kata. Ha, itu dia. Untuk kumpul experience tu, kan, dia ada ke macam tempoh yang afdal untuk dikumpul, or macam 2 tahun je okey dah, dia boleh sambung. Ha, kita soalan dia.
I would say tak ada pun tempoh yang afdal. So, dia lebih kepada once actually your confidence. Okay, macam I mentioned just now, when you be invited for the interview, okay, you need to do the mock teaching. Maybe for those
Miss Kai sangkut.
Kan?
Okay.
Miss Kai?
Miss sangkut. Miss Kai?
Okay. Ah.
Okay. Okay. So actually that's about free over there. Okay, so apa tadi?
So for me, where were you just
now? I was joining. Okay, can I continue? I thought a bit again for me.
Okay. Okay.
Okay, done. Okay.
That's kind of okay.
So they will ask you to choose the topic. Okay, topic meaning that which one that you feel is comfortable for you to talk, I mean to teach. So masa tu I still remember, yang I mesti tak ingat, tapi yang Taylor saya ingat, I choose topic sponsorship. So masa sponsorship, I mean masa mock teaching tu, we just need to teach lah. Okay, we teach it. Okay, we teach, and then that's actually the experience. So based on the mock teaching, actually the interviewer can see, oh budak ni boleh, dia ni boleh. So back to the question asking by Natasha ni, tak ada pun tempoh idah ke, kena ada 1 year, 2 years, tak ada. It actually depends your experience and your confidence nak cakap depan orang. Because I mentioned just now, when you want to be as a lecturer, 2 things, the skill that you need to have. Practical, communication. Okay, dalam kelas actually communication is very important. Like macam Miss Nana mentioned just now, if the student ask you a question, you tak confirm what's actually the answer that you want to give to the student, you tak boleh cakap, tak tahulah what's the answers. So the best thing is actually you need to, I will refer back to you. Maybe the next class we'll discuss about it. Okay, then after you need to find. Kita kena perlu lah. So kita kena pandai goreng sambil adat. Okay, but in terms of pandai goreng, you should be relate back with your experience.
Gitu. Betul. Apa nama tu? Macam Natasha tanya tadi, addressing the same question lah. I would say, betul. Memang there's no like skema jawapan kepada soalan Natasha tu kan. So, maksudnya okay, you have to have experience for 3 years. There are some programs sebenarnya yang perlukan macam tu. Macam contohnya macam mass communication kan. There are some scholarship yang bila you nak sambung ke mass communication punya masters ataupun PhD level, they require you to have a industry related field for 5 years, for example. Macam nak jadi position apa, dapatkan jawatan dekat company kan, managerial kena 5 tahun, kalau executive tu 2 tahun macam tu, kalau CEO maybe more than 10 years macam tu kan. So terpulang kepada apa orang panggil tu, whether you think you are equipped enough to enter the academic world to share your knowledge. And then you have to remember yang walaupun you dah dalam education punya industri ni, it's not going to stop there. You always have to unlearn some old things kan, some dinosaur punya information dah kena kan, dah tak related dah kan. So macam for example MIRC kan, kalau kita sebut sekarang ni macam student macam apa benda kan MIRC macam tu kan. So it's actually a chatting punya software ataupun apps dulu kan, zaman dulu-dulu kita guna. Tapi there are some things yang kita tak boleh hold on forever. So bila you rasa you have enough experience in the industry, how would you know macam tu kan? You katanya macam mana nak tahu ni kalau I duduk tengah kerja, I dah cukup ke tak kan? Sambil-sambil you kerja tu kan, after 1 year ke after 2 years tu, you go ahead and apply for masters kan. Sambil you belajar tu, you belajar kan, you sit for your master's class. Lepas tu ataupun kalau ada scholarship yang keluar, you go and grab kan. Lepas tu masa teaching tu nanti you will know lah, oh so according to this experienced people, I am ready to be a lecturer macam tu.
Betul. Ada Iwan AC tanya.
Hi Iwan.
Sekarang alai ke Miss? Saya rasa soalan ni tadi untuk yang ada soalan ni untuk yang scholarship misalnya tadi ada lagi ke sampai sekarang? Ada lagi ke?
Cuma dia jarang keluar kan sekarang ni because the reason is because apa nama tu, monetary lah issue kan. So scholarship ni datang daripada kerajaan. Jadi kan our government has a very important matters to focus on right now, Iwan. So sebab itulah mungkin scholarship ni lebih kepada dalaman lah kan, rather than they offer this scholarship to external. Okay, so sebenarnya kalau you dah bekerja, lepas tu you already have make steady money, sebenarnya masters and PhD punya yuran tu tidaklah expensive. Betul. Sangat kan, it's not like you're especially going UITM. Out overseas. Ha, exactly, betul, UITM lah. So siapa punya Shopee tu?
Saya.
Okay. Alright, so okay. Reminder kan esok 9-9 lah. So Iwan, you boleh search not only UITM offer TPM, I rasa UKM pun pernah offer juga, UPM pun ada. Tapi if you have extra money on your own, you go and sambung. Lepas tu nanti bila ada opening, you apply. Kan? Always check out the vacancies in the faculties of IPTE of your choices lah.
Lepas tu kita Hanis. Ada soalan lagi. Hanis Syarikat tanya, mock teaching tu susah tak kalau yang tak pernah experience mengajar?
Oh, sejuk tangan I, Fika. Sejuk kaki tangan I because this reminds me of how awful I did when I was mock teaching. Okay, because macam I cakap lah kan, I don't know what's the correct intonation to teach kan, to speak ataupun to communicate when you're teaching. So when I teach, like when I speak, it doesn't resonate well with the people who are being my panel masa tu lah kan. Because bila kita mengajar ni, there's some sort of pace yang kita kena cakap ni, perlahan-perlahan kan. Miss Kau ni cakap laju. Okay, macam kan, so macam tak sabar-sabar nak keluarkan perkataan muntah-muntah-muntah macam tu. So that's why it was really like I was laughing at myself lah. Tak payah, tapi dia orang pun gelak sama dengan I lah, so it was fun. Okay, so for me it was horrible kan, but it was funny. Cuma rasa macam kelakar lah masa tu. Okay.
Hanis, if I want to ask this question kan, Hanis question, dia tanya susah ke tak It depends sebab for my experience, I prepare because the management said that you need to prepare around 15 slides and then it's around 15 minutes. Okay, tapi it depends if for example that within 5 minutes, they feel that, okay, budak ni boleh pergi, then they will stop you. Penat, you prepare the slides, you mock teaching in front of the mirror, tapi they stop you at 5 minutes, something like that. So, susah ke tak tu, nak jawab pun susah ke tak, because it depends to the situation, kan?
Tips yeah. Maybe, tips when you are preparing for your mock teaching, rather than you focus on impressing the panels, you focus on delivering content yang you nak sampaikan. Yes. Katalah kan macam kan masa saya ngajar mock teaching hari tu, I guna PR kan, selatif yang baru saja bersara kan, because I was really amazed of how he taught during my degree years. Lepas tu kita macam rasa macam benda tu simpan lama lah kan, so I rasa macam kalau there's something I think I'm good at is PR, so I nak ngajar PR lah masa mock teaching tu kan. So I was focusing on, okay, you faham tak macam mana PR ni, macam nak benda tu yang dalam kepala tu yang rasa macam banyak sangat benda nak keluar kat mulut tu ya, tapi nak laju-laju kan lah. So rather than focusing on, okay, how do I impress them kan, with my attire ke, macam like me macam tu kan, rather than that you focus on the content macam tu.
Gitu. Okay, kita ada lagi soalan di sini, panjang soalan dia
kan.
Okay, Mirci tanya, apa pendapat Miss tentang situasi pembelajaran sekarang compared to situation before? Susah tak untuk Miss catch up dengan the term? Contoh macam dari segi penggunaan digital platform dan sebagainya. Macam mana?
Okay, I go first lah.
Boleh.
Sebab Miss Nana macam teman dulu.
Okay. I will say that situasi pembelajaran sekarang compare will be very different, very very different. I don't know what your ITM lah, but then for Talents itself, kita since pandemic start last year kan, March, kita macam kejap your campus, and then a few months or few weeks after that, management kata sorry, ministry kata tak boleh, then we go back to the class, virtual class. So it will be quite difficult for the module yang ada practical part, because kalau let's say practical physical event, we just organize the event kan, but then for if it's a virtual class or online class, macam mana kita nak organize event? So it comes to the very challenging, not only for the students tapi lecturer juga. Because me myself, to be honest, I tak tahu pun Zoom tu apa. I didn't know how the function of the Zoom. Okay, Microsoft Teams, I tak tahu macam mana. Same. So that all the platform tu come in, kan? Kita tak ada tua sangat kan to know all that technology.
Kan, kita muda lagi lah. Hello.
Kita muda lagi sebenarnya. Tapi we did not have that experience, but it's actually not thanks to the pandemic, tapi because of the pandemic, we know all the technology term, we know Zoom, okay, we know this one, apa ni, StreamYard and so on. So when ask a question, susah ke tak, I would say it's very challenging, especially for the events management program and then events management yang ada course practical part. It will be very challenging for lecturers, because kita as a lecturer, we need to learn first. Kita nak ajar students ni, kita kena tahu Zoom tu apa, Microsoft Teams tu apa. And then if for example we want our students to organize the event in and then maybe for example the streaming from live Facebook, macam mana nak buat? Tapi sometimes kan the students lagi expert daripada kita tahu.
Betul lah. So it's actually just about to say that sometimes. Diorang yang sebenarnya lagi advance, macam why not you use this miss, it's a gaming punya software, macam oh dah kena jadi gamer pula dah. Okay. Tapi kan it's not kita tak boleh lah kata susah kan, kita kata dia challenging, it's macam it's more of adapting tu. Bila kita dah berjaya adapt kan, when it becomes our new like everyday, macam dah jadi dah biasa macam tu kan, it's like as easy as breathing macam tu lah. Okay, so tapi memang kita kena allow time untuk adapt. Lepas tu kita kena macam mesti ada rasa frustrated tu, kena ada, kena rasa kan, kena mengaku yang kita frustrated lah. Lepas tu after that you overcome lah kan, nangis lah dulu kan, bebai dulu. Lepas tu you overtook that macam tu. Habis bebai dah lah, jangan bebai lama-lama macam tu. Okay, Mirce, very good question.
You're muted, I think, Afika.
sorry semua. Okay, I student pun, I first time guna StreamYard ni. Kalau macam Miss Nana tahu lagi StreamYard daripada I, kan macam itulah, nampak tak? Kalau misalnya kata Miss Nana muda lagi, I muda pun tak tahu StreamYard tu apa. Tapi effort
very lah. It's hard, you know. We have to keep, yeah, like we have to catch up with you. We have to keep up with you macam tu kan. So siapa tadi, Arina Syazana cakap dia macam sambil mengajar kita belajar. That's true. Very very true kan. You cannot have that that feeling yang you rasa macam I've semua dah I tahu dah kan. I dah tahu apa you nak tahu, apa you nak. Tak boleh. Kita tak boleh ada rasa bongkak takabur macam tu, tak boleh. Kan, because we have always be apa nama tu, remember, kita kena selalu ingat yang there will always be something that we can learn from the learners kan, from the students themselves kan. Kita ada something yang kita boleh impart to them, kita pun ada benda yang kita boleh belajar dari orang macam tu.
Betul. Okay, so kita dah tak ada question kaitan tu. Kita nak loncat ke question seterusnya. Banyak question tadi. Okay, next question. Macam kalau kita nak edit lecture, apa dia karakter, macam ideal karakter lah untuk kita jadi seorang lecturer. So okay. Hello. Okay. Macam kita nak jadi event lecturer, macam kita nak jadi lecturer, apa dia ideal karakter yang perlu kita ada untuk sesuatu universiti tu ambil kita? Macam dia macam, oh kalau dia tengok budak ni, karakter dia ni, okay dia ni boleh jadi pensyarah. So apa karakter tu yang kena ada kat kita? Itulah soalan.
If you asking me, macam I cakap tadi, the first thing is actually of course the communication skill. Okay, because you will interact with the students, you will interact with the management, and at the same time you will also interact with the stakeholders. It's either internal ke external stakeholders kan. Tapi kalau katakanlah kita punya character sendiri, I would say that two things. First, you need to have a patient. Kesabaran yang amatlah tinggi. Okay, kesabaran yang amat tinggi, because kenapa you need to have patience, because it comes to the second character. You need to have a multitasking skill, multitasking skill. Sebab some of the people, they feel that to be as a lecturer or teacher ni senang je, because we just go to the class and then we teach, habis kelas balik. Okay, which is wrong. Okay, to be multitasking meaning that we need to do admin part, and the admin part tu termasuklah you need to prepare the final exam, you need to prepare at the end of the semester, you need to prepare the report of your students. Lepas tu we need to do research. Apa lagi, you need to refer to the student assessment project, especially for the event lecture. You need to monitor students punya progress of the event, sometimes competition. So that's the reason why multitasking is very important. I just want to share experience, not my experience, actually my adalah seseorang yang I kenal. When he joined, he's from industry, okay, and then at the first time he joined the education line, okay, and then he thought that teaching is easy. Tapi dia tak ada multitasking tau. When he did not have multitasking, and then at the one time dia boleh teaching dia. So when we ask him to prepare the exam, dia tak boleh. Dia tak boleh fokus. Kalau dia prepare exam question, then dia tak boleh monitor students punya competition, for example. If he focus on the student competition, dia tak boleh fokus dekat kelas. So that's actually the thing lah, that from my opinion. Patient, kesabaran yang amat tinggi, and second multitasking multitasking skill.
Betul.
Karakter, soalan Afika tadi, apa karakter?
Karakter seorang lecturer.
Sentiasa suka mengambil tahu tentang you punya bidang. Macam tu, bukan mengambil tahu hal orang. Yang tu pun kena juga sometimes kan, especially when it comes to your student kan, bila dia susah ke, dia ni apa nama tu, that dia tak banyak pengetahuan ke, apa nama tu, so benda-benda macam tu pun kena ambil tahu juga. Tapi lebih kepada, because you always have to increase your knowledge kan, you have to always keep up to date with the theories, especially in your field. Sebab itulah awal-awal tadi Miss Hairiyah dah sebut dah pasal research kan. If you're someone, this is me speaking to myself as well lah kan, if you're someone who don't like research ataupun you rasa macam, oh research is not my thing, dia macam you have no option kan, that's not an option lah, macam tu lah jawapan dia. Okay, because you are an academician right now, so you kena menulis, you kena research, you kena membaca, you kena kenal siapa pioneer and who's the, like sekarang ni siapa leading ataupun who's changing that culture ataupun that old theory tu lah, macam tu. So kena sentiasa ada sikap ambil tahu tu lah kan. So it brings you to like, mesti kena suka membaca lah. Kalau you rasa macam, oh I baca memang I punya kelemahan kan. Baik. Tak boleh. As academician, you kena membaca kan. So you have to accept that one day you akan pakai that reading glass tu.
Kan. I rasa macam selamatlah sikit sebab I macam boleh membaca tapi tak boleh mengira. Selamat.
Kan? Okay, that's a good combination. So, because there are a lot of there's a lot of lecturer especially yang bahagian social study ni, kita tidak expert. We are not great mathematician ataupun orang statistik lah senang ceritakan. Okay, so apa nama, that's why okay, boleh ada bidang untuk you. Maksudnya there are some field that is ready for you in the academician punya line. Sahabat agree yang boy Miss Azura tu.
Aduh,
ada masalah Miss Azura tu. Abah Muaz ni Dr. Masrur ke?
Okay. Salam Miss Kiria. Apa kata?
Ya.
Okay. Dah. Miss Kiria, Miss Azura kata open-minded, non-judgmental, adaptable gitu. Okay. Okay, kita ada soalan daripada Christina Aisyah. Ha, dia kata, as a lecturer sendiri, how Miss handle the multitasking work and manage your mental health to always give positive vibes to other people?
Ha, sebab kejap dulu untuk soalan Christina. Terima kasih Christina for considering our mental health. Dah tak apa-apa betul lah ni mental lah. Empat tu lah jadi apa-apa ni.
Hai.
Tadi Fika, you were saying, you tengok sendiri. Okay,
untuk soalan ni.
Oh, this question lah. Christina Aisyah question.
Ni. So, I macam
always reward yourself. Always reward yourself. Especially after the semester end, kan after all the headache punya kerja, okay, after marking paper, something like that, and then usually we do have few months before the new semester start, kan. So reward yourself, nak pergi mana-mana, pergi. Okay, if you want to buy something, besok is nai-nai, kan. Shopee is always active during this pandemic. So always reward yourself. So yeah. That's only the thing that I can do lah because of the pandemic now, kan, we cannot travel. So pandai-pandai lah manage your mental health.
Tadi Afika ada cakap tadi sebab you sendiri, bila you baca question ni dan you cakap kata sebab you sendiri pun sambung?
Sebab I sendiri pun nampak, sekejap. Sebab I sendiri pun nampak Miss saya lah, Miss Zura, semua tu very, walaupun dalam keadaan, kami tahu lecturer semua stress, macam very mental health macam semua orang lah. Bukan student je, I tahu lecturer pun mental health pun kena jaga. And then Miss lecturer ni semua macam very, walaupun dalam keadaan gitu very bersemangat nak ajar student-student dia, tak nampak pun macam ada problem langsung. Dia macam, I pun tanya-tanya soalan yang sama macam mana Christina je tanya ni.
Superhuman lah. Superhuman eh. First of all, apa nama I nak cakap, bila you become a lecturer ni, kan, an academician ni, of course you punya paksi tu, kan, you punya center tu, it always have to be teaching, kan. Kita tak boleh nak mengelak daripada kata macam, oh tapi lecturer dia lain, kan, dia cluster lain macam tu, tidak, kan, dia tidak ada kayangan ke apa, tapi dia punya center tu still teaching, kan. So if you feel like that's your flair, kan, ataupun that's your center, sebab tu lah I rasa apa-apa pun cabaran ataupun challenges ataupun anything that shake your world, if your center is still, maksudnya memang kekal your center, InsyaAllah you'll be okay, kan. So how do we handle multitasking? Not me, we lah, me and myself. I lebih kepada enjoying what I do, kan. Okay, bila kita enjoy what we do, kan, rather than looking at some apa nama, apa yang mendatang tu sebagai something that I have to complain about, I look at it, kalau benda tu macam sangat annoying ataupun menyakitkan hati, kita bye-bye lah, macam saya cakap tadi, kan, kita bye-bye sekejap, kita go rant at someone yang boleh mendengar, kan. And sometimes betul, I rasa Miss Azura and also many of your lecturers sendiri jadikan students tu sendiri untuk jadi tempat the punching bag, kan. And sometimes kita we are very lucky that we found students yang very understanding, kan, and very like pendengar yang baik lah, and diorang ni pun blessing in disguise juga, kan. So seronok lah bila kita jumpa students yang macam ni. It's not like we are trying to macam kau lah punya perangai ni, so you kena dengar apa yang nak bebel, bukan, tapi macam memang benda tu rezeki juga, kan. And then how do we manage your mental health and always give positive vibes to other people. Sama juga. So as long as your center is betul yang you suka, yang memang betul you punya flan, you punya passion, I think benda tu akan always overtake whatever it is that comes. Lepas tu ada satu, bukan quote lah, it's a speech. Macam masa my colleague ni dia berhenti ataupun dia bersara. Okay, we thought Dr. Siti Mariam nama dia kan, daripada Faculty Business UiTM Kedah. Bila dia bersara hari tu, dia bagi speech, tapi speech tu pendek je kan. We were looking forward to hear pasal dia nak reminiscing zaman muda kan, zaman muda remaja dekat UiTM Kedah daripada zaman pembukaan ke apa. Tak ada. Dia cakap, I enjoyed the whole how many years yang she served there, and my advice to this you all young people, if you don't love what you do, quit ataupun leave, dia kata. Hah, senang je. Kan? So very simple, like very wow. Okay, baik, senang. Sebab apa? Sebab kita ni suka complain je. Complain. If you don't like what you do, leave. Ha, macam tu kan? So as simple as that. Tapi it's not easy, isn't it? Sebab apa? Sebab we still want the perks. We still want the benefits. We still want that easiness, benda seronok, gaji sedap duduk, alhamdulillah kan? Tapi we complain. Tak boleh. It doesn't go. Sebab itulah kita akan ada mental issue tu. Because you're not staying true to what you're feeling. Macam tu kan? So, always stay true to what your center is lah. Tu, I think that's my...
Okay. Kalau Miss... Kai pula punya opinion, ada macam nak handle. Ha. Kalau Miss Kai pula,
macam mana Rasmi? Kita nak question ke? Yang ni? How to handle the stress ke? I think I'm a bit lagging kot. Tapi I hope that you can hear my voice now. Is it like still lagging?
Okay dah.
So how to handle mental health? I think I tend to agree with what Miss Nana mentioned just now. Inside here, you kena ada satu feeling yang you like the management, even though you hate the management. Okay, even though maybe you hate your boss kan, for example. Tapi once you ada, for contoh once you ada that feeling kan, then you will rasa tak best tau nak buat kerja, nak pergi kerja every day, something like that. So that's where if you have that feeling, benci management, benci your boss, something like that, then will come to mental health. So first, always positive, and then I want to use back my answer just now is actually you need to reward yourself.
Reward
yourself. Okay. For every achievement,
Zura cakap,
reward yourself.
Zura cakap mantra Dr. Nurul. That's your supervisor. Your
supervisor. Pretty supervisor, kan? Betul. Yes, Afika. Back to you, Afika.
So itulah dia. Kalau tadi tu. Okay. Kalau macam tadi kita dah tengok sikit lah, nampaklah sikit soalan yang actually soalan yang selepas ni macam berkait sikit dengan soalan Kina Aisyah ni, which is nak tahu jadi lecturer ni susah tak? Macam apa challenge dia jadi orang lecturer? Ha, tu. Ha, macam tadi tu mental health tu one of it lah kan? Macam one of time pandemic dah. Maybe ada yang lain lagi.
Bagi I, if you love what you do, everything is easy. Kan, benda susah, benda kita, suddenly kita kena buat online class. I tak reti apa, I don't know jack squat about technology. But I love to teach, I want to meet my student, I want to give them the knowledge that they deserve ataupun the rights ni kan, dia orang punya hak ni untuk dapatkan knowledge ni. So I'm gonna learn, macam tu. Kan, so tak kira, if you love what you do, it's always easy kan. Benda yang I paling dread nak buat pun, I akan cuba korek motivation and capability untuk fulfill ataupun untuk completekan, macam tu. That's my answer lah.
Okay, for me, based on the question just now, Afika, I will say that my challenges is time constraint. Time. That is actually my big challenges. So back to what I sharing just now, my journey kan. The reason of why maybe, I don't know lah, if there's someone of you asking me a question, why I need to resign from MSU untuk further master. Because at the time, my daughter was 4 years old masa tu. So I'm afraid that I cannot balance my life as a teacher, as a wife, as a mom, kan? So I need to make a decision that I need to resign and focus to my master because I believe that I want to be in this industry. Kan kalau tak, will be time constraint. Even now when I was in Telus University, it's still time constraints is a main challenges because macam Miss Nanda cakap, even you want to join private university or public university, one of the requirement is actually apa PhD kan? So currently I'm doing my PhD dekat UPM, and it's very time challenging, time constrained, because we in the private university, we do not have a study leave macam UiTM, or not UiTM lah, it's actually all the public university macam 3 years, right? From second 3 years, betul tak Miss Lana? 3 years.
Betul.
Kan? So me myself, you know how long, marah pula my boss kalau tengok ni. But it's actually, we didn't have like 1 year study leave, or to maybe 2 years, something like that. My study leave is only 2 months here, which is my study leave last year, and then it's during short semester, 2 months. So can you imagine that in 2 months you need to do your research, your PhD is very, very time constrained. And even now I'm struggling with everything. Susah lah. Time lah. It's actually, that's actually my main challenge, just time. Itulah dia.
Okay, kita ada soalan daripada Natasha Eddy. Most people cakap, jadi lecturer ni kerja yang bagus, banyak benefit. Tapi ada tak downside of being a lecturer?
Soalan. I rasa semua kerja ada, bukanlah downside, challenges kan. Rather than downside tu, downside is too negative of a word untuk kita guna kepada kerjaya yang kita ada untuk mencari rezeki, kan? Because that is sumber rezeki, sumber nafkah kita. So we shouldn't critique ataupun we shouldn't bash kita punya sumber rezeki, kan? Tapi of course every job I rasa akan ada dia punya downside ataupun challenges lah. Okay, so challenges dia, it would be very difficult for a person to encounter kalau dia tak ada skill ataupun aptitude yang betul. Macam for example, katalah macam Miss Kai cakap tadi, kawan dia tak pandai multitasking, maybe not a people person, kan? So don't like to be approached by people. Masalahnya you jadi lecturer ni, all you do is interact with people, kan? Kan? So macam manalah, so it's going to be very hard on him kalau dia orang yang macam tu, kan? I don't like people, kan? Lepas tu ajar student, I prefer my students not to be human. Lepas tu aku nak ajar apa, kerusi, meja, macam tu, kan? Susah. So macam pencara di UiTM, siapa tadi yang tanya ni? Damia. Siapa?
Natasha
juga. Natasha Eddy. So macam pensyara di UiTM, kita bukan sekadar teaching and learning. We are not only teach and we don't only learn, kan? We have to do research. There are seven bakul ataupun seven job scope sebenarnya lah. So for a pensyarah, kan, jawatan tu nama dia pensyarah. So kita ingat, oh, bersyarah je lah kerja dia. No, kan? So that itu untuk pensyarah ataupun grade pensyarah, ataupun dia menjalankan tugas ataupun tanggungjawab sebagai seorang pensyarah je. Belum yang menjadi koordinator, yang menjadi ketua unit, yang jadi fellow, yang jadi, you know, you understand no, what I'm saying? So maksudnya, selain daripada 7 bakul atau 7 job scope, basik pensyarah yang dia perlu buat tu, ada lagi jawatan ataupun tanggungjawab lain yang dia kena carry. So it is very, very challenging. Okay, I cerita satu benda. When I was working in the industry in 2010, macam saya cakap tadi lah, I was happy, seronok dah, gaji pun alhamdulillah tak adalah besar, tapi I can make do macam tu, kan. It is a private punya industry ataupun private punya company, tapi ada bila I dapat scholarship tu, ada seorang one of my acquaintance tu, dia cakap, ambil lah jadi pensyarah, kan, stable sikit, apa orang panggil tu, gaji tu insyaAllah pencen lah, macam tu senang sikit katanya, kan. Tapi how that was, yeah, mistaken sangat, kan. And alhamdulillah nasib baik I tidak ambil, nasib baik I tidak ambil that point to become like my reason tau kenapa I pilih untuk ambil that scholarship and become a lecturer, because that's so not true, there's a lot of responsibility that you need to, and sebenarnya I lagi busy daripada masa I kerja dekat luar academic punya line. Betul. Yeah, it's not like I can be ibu misalnya di rumah masak-masak buat YouTube channel. And mind you, ada je pensyarah yang ada that kind of thing, you know. Kan, not only that he or she is good tanggungjawab dia sebagai seorang pensyarah, tapi dia punya social life and social capabilities pun wow juga. Macam tu.
Okay. Kalau Miss Kai pula macam mana?
Okay, for me, maybe I would like to continue from what Miss Lana mentioned just now. We don't want to call it as the downside or dark side of being a lecturer. Tapi one thing that we need to remember, once you be as a lecturer, you will be observed. Meaning, I thought sure UiTM lah, but then for the private university, meaning that you will be observed by your superior. Okay, maybe program manager, program director, dean ke, head of school. And the most important thing is actually the students. Because every semester, in TELUS University, we do have like macam, we call it a TES, teaching engagement skill, where the students will give a feedback. Okay, lecture ni, how is actually her teaching style? Manage start to get all the learning outcomes that she deliver, dapat ke tak? Okay, how the content? So from there, if for example, the feedback is negative, then maybe it will be downside for you lah. So like, apalah budak ni. Okay, because we feel that we're not able to fulfill whatever that they want. Tapi kita just take it as positive lah. For the next semester, we improve. If for example, the student say that, ni suka cakap banyak. And we didn't give any opportunity to the student to say something. So maybe next semester, okay, kita tanya. Ni yang diorang nak kan, kita tanya. So always be positive with the feedback or observation made by the students and the superior itself. Bukan downside lah, ni tak habis pula downside ataupun downside.
We wouldn't name it downside kan, tapi dia lebih kepada, you know, it's just how it is. Maksudnya there are things yang kita kena, we are going to have to handle ataupun manage. So mesti kena ada ni issue kita kena solve, problems we have to counter kan. Lepas tu kita akan ada lah criticism, negative comments, semua biasa. Kan, tambah UiTM ni kan seronok, baru viral. Thank you Natasha again. Betul macam Natasha cakap, macam sufo, betul? Talking about sufo. So, untuk UiTM ni SUFO, dia student evaluation on lecturers lah. So don't be afraid to be honest in your SUFO, because the lecturer wouldn't know siapa yang evaluate. So kalau betul there are things yang you rasa that lecturer needs to improve, you just be honest in your SUFO evaluation tu, because that would definitely help the lecturer tu.
Begitu. Okay, masa tu tak berapa. Saya banyak soalan tanya tapi masa menceburui, betul eh? Ha, tu. So last. Macam apa dia advice untuk fresh grad yang mungkin ada cerita untuk menjadi seorang lecturer di masa akan datang? Ha, macam tu.
No rush. One word. No rush. Because kalau let's say you really want to be as a lecturer kan, no rush, meaning that I nak jadi lecturer, I nak further master. Tak apa, sabar dulu, master tu tak ke mana. Like I think that's one of the comment mentioned here, yang you can do the same thing at the same time, meaning that you are working, then at the same time if you capable to do that multitasking, kita buat. Okay, sambung belajar, kerja. One thing is never resign, macam mana buat pula. Okay, because actually now it's quite difficult to get job, betul tak? It's difficult to get job. Memang I rasa itu rezeki I lah. So semua orang rezeki lain-lain kan. So one thing, never resign. Kalau let's say for example you feel that you want to be as a lecturer, tak apa, kita kerja dulu. At the same time you rasa dah stabil, then lepas tu kita further lah master. Okay, and then with that experience, dengan master certification, dual qualification, kita apply untuk lecture. Yeah. So actually that one lah.
Yeah. No rush. So macam bagus, good. Apa nama tu, good advice, no rush. In fact, in anything, no rush. Okay, memang betul apa orang panggil, we have to live our life to the fullest. But you have to be like, macam kena berdiri, berpijak di atas bumi yang ada lah, macam tu kan. So don't try to macam mencapai something that you cannot grasp lah, macam tu. Okay, Damia ada tanya tadi.
Damia tanya.
Ya, kita kena ada knowledge yang tinggi ke. I would say kan, rather than knowledge yang tinggi, you kena ada sikap sentiasa ingin belajar yang tinggi kan. Yang tinggi tadi, yang paling tinggi tu adalah academic qualification lah, like we mentioned. Academic qualification yang paling tinggi yang ada dekat dalam dunia ni adalah PhD lah kan. Maybe you have lepas PhD ada postdoc, tapi memang academic qualification yang you boleh dapat scroll tu paling tinggi adalah PhD. Kan, even then, bila you dah ada PhD pun, dia tidak akan menjamin yang you dah tahu semua benda. kan? Betul. Because mesti learning. Kita cakap tadi, yeah, you always have to still learn. Lepas tu, there are some things yang you dah tahu, you kena unlearn, kena delete. Delete from your hard drive tu, kan? And there's some things yang you have to always relearn, kan? Kenapa kena relearn? Mungkin sebab the theory is there, tapi the way it is being applicable dekat dalam industri tu mungkin dah berbeza, kan? Macam tu. So, advice I untuk somebody yang nak jadi pensyarah adalah you look back ataupun you kaji balik the reason why you want to become a lecturer. Kenapa you nak jadi pensyarah? Kan? Is it for the, there are intrinsic apa nama, motivation yang intrinsic yang dalaman and also extrinsic, kan? There are some of us yang mungkin I seronok mengajar. The student motivates me ataupun when I teach, I feel some sort of satisfaction. Macam tu kan. Ataupun because you feel like internally you have so many things to share. Macam tu kan. So apa nama tu, when you find that like flare membara-bara dekat dalam your center tu, you go for it. Okay, so collect as many, masa you belajar sekarang ni, adik-adik yang sedang belajar bachelor degree in event management ataupun any bachelor degree, make sure you score. Okay, as an academician, you have to have good academics results.
Yeah, right? That's one of the requirement, kan?
Yeah, of course, yeah, itu definitely kan. And then not only that, you have to know how to, bila you dah tahu, macam mana you nak kasih orang lain tak tahu, kan? So that's very important in becoming a teacher lah. Basically kan, a lecturer, you kena tahu the skill of teaching back, macam tu. Kalau you tahu, lepas tu macam, tapi I tak reti lah nak bagi orang faham, then susah sikit lah. Maksudnya there's lot more skills yang you kena acquire. Lepas tu, yes, lepas tu bila you gather your knowledge ataupun experience in the industry, at the back of your mind, always have the next steps on becoming, on achieving yang ambition tadi tu, nak jadi pensyarah. So dia punya realistic punya steps adalah kena ada masters, kena ada PhD. So always work on that. Tapi while you are gathering experience in the industry, so kena be a little bit apa macam tu, ada strategi lah, kena ada strategi. Okay, Afrika? Kan? Kasa umur dia tu, tak nak jadi pensyarah, kan? So this is what, kan, next semester dapat 5, right? So maintain your GPA. Kan dapat 5 dah. So pasti intern, starting from your intern tu, you kena macam tamak lah. Okay, apa lagi I belajar, apa lagi lah, macam tu.
Right? Kira kena mengejar apa pun semuanya. Kena mengejar semuanya untuk get the experience. Betul. Okay. Jadi thank you Miss Kai and Miss Nana for the advice and for your sharing today. Very, it's very good input untuk korang yang nak lecturer. Take note apa yang Miss Nana and Miss Kai sebut tadi. So nanti boleh digunakan untuk masa hadapan. Ha, okay. So sampai di sini sajalah kita punya sharing session. Kita punya tea and coffee. Cik, tambah-tambah je coffee.
Habis
lah. Nanti
kopi kita banyak nak cakap. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you so much. And then jangan lupa. Ya, yeah, sama. Jangan lupa.
Sorry, so last word for me lah. So I'm looking forward to see Afrika and then all maybe for those who are looking forward to be as a lecturer. Kita jumpa di Talis University maybe another few more years, kan?
Tolong join us, kan? Kita dah tak larat nak jadi junior dah. I'm so old to become a junior but not so that old lah, kan? Come and join us
insyaAllah,
ya?
InsyaAllah. Okay, thank you Miss Kan, thank you Miss Nana. Okay, for you all yang di YouTube, jangan lupa tekan subscribe. Kalau siapa tak subscribe lagi, like, share dengan kawan-kawan. After this, kita akan save live ni untuk kegunaan masa hadapan semestinya. And then itu sahajalah daripada saya. Maaf kalau ada terkasar bahasa. Kalau yang baik itu datang daripada Allah, daripada yang tak baik itu datang dari saya lah. So terima kasih. Okay, itu sahaja daripada kami. Terima kasih semua sudi mendengar.
Thank you. All the best. Good luck for your result lagi 2 hari.
Really?
Miss, saya dah lupa. Oh my god.